他被称为欧元之父。
Well, I don't call myself the father. There are other people founding the
nation. 面对欧元区的困境，他在想什么？
Fiscal aspects of it was to impose penalties.
他通过货币视角观察中国经济走向。
China will be able to keep its hand in partly in all phases at the same time, all different levels.
欢迎收看中央电视台财经频道特别节目《欧元波动中的蒙代尔》。大家好，欢迎收看中央电视台财经频道特别节目《欧元之父罗伯特·蒙代尔》，我是艾诚。那这个世界呢，正在因为全球化和互联网等因素变得越来越小，就连欧债这个听起来和我们中国人没有什么直接关系的词汇，也正在深刻影响着很多中国企业的发展甚至是生存。比如说本月的六号，欧盟对中国光伏企业发起了反倾销调查，这在很大程度上就是因为欧债危机导致了欧盟对华贸易的保护主义抬头。我想这个案例至少可以让我们深刻地感受到两点，第一是欧债危机仍在蔓延，第二是欧债危机已经影响到了中国。如果要反思这场危机，我们可能需要回到13年前去审视一个叫做欧元的伟大创举。也就是在那一年，1999年，经济学家罗伯特·蒙代尔凭借最优货币区理论获得了当年的诺贝尔经济学奖，并被尊称为欧元之父。那面对现在欧元区此刻的困局，欧元之父会想些什么呢？罗伯特·蒙代尔1932年出生于加拿大安大略省，1956年在美国麻省理工学院获得经济学博士学位。在经济学界，蒙代尔和克鲁格曼、斯特尔并称为全球单一货币体系的理论铁三角。1999年，67岁的蒙代尔获得了诺贝尔经济学奖，理由就是他在1957年创建的最优货币区理论，而当时的蒙代尔只有25岁。
I guess the American Economic Review chose that as in the last 100 years the most important article. It's one of the 20 most important articles it's had.
Would you mind sharing your theory with the Chinese audience?
The question of the theory is, first of all, what is it that a currency is supposed to do? Typically, a currency has been a political expression of sovereignty, and it is that still today. To some extent, currency domains are often reflect imperial domains. In the world of the ancient empires, the British Empire had the unit of account, the pound sterling, that was dominant, and other empires all used the same currency all through their empires. So that's been an important part of the currency. Now the question is, what is the optimum way from a purely economic standpoint? And link in that was to develop a counterpart to, in the theory of international trade was different from domestic trade because domestically factors of production are mobile. Internationally, they're not so mobile. Labor doesn't move from one country to another. And so that, in fact, turned out to be one basis for my criterion of an optimum currency area.The zone of labor mobility was an important thing. That's certainly for the optimum single currency area.
基于这样的理论，蒙代尔最早提出了欧洲单一货币的设想，并且在1969年就为欧洲货币制定了第一项规划。30年之后，1999年，在欧洲各国的努力之下，欧元正式诞生。蒙代尔也因此站在了诺贝尔奖的领奖台上。
And what was the most impressive moment for you?
Nothing. Well, I suppose my speech at the on December 10th, that Friday, when I made this very special impromptu. We had a prepared speech. It has to be 2 or 3 minutes at the maximum. It has to be very short. 1,500 people all in their white ties and tails, and so I changed my speech at the beginning to mention that my son was going to be married in Stockholm the next night by the Lord Mayor of Stockholm, and that everybody in the room was invited to the wedding. That was the, and then I finished off the speech with a verse from the Frank Sinatra's My Way. I did it my way.
采访中，蒙代尔告诉我，那一天呢，他不仅完成了一个与众不同的诺奖获奖演说，他还在领奖台上唱了一首歌，这首歌的名字叫做《我只是走自己的路而已》。就像这首歌唱的一样，蒙代尔一直就是一个特立独行的人，以至于在他获得诺奖的时候，《纽约时报》的评论是，这是一个行为古怪的经济学家。不过呢，也许正是这样的风格让他有机会成为欧元的发明者。成立欧元的导火索是上世纪七十年代初布雷顿森林体系的崩溃，当时美元大幅贬值，让欧洲国家体会到了巨大的贸易痛苦，于是建立统一的货币被提上了日程。1986年，法国财长德鲁尔发起了单一市场计划。1990年，在欧洲货币联盟的政府峰会上，由德国央行起草的欧洲央行章程，在1991年的马斯特里赫特峰会上获得通过。1999年1月1日，欧元正式出台。此后十年间，欧元区整体失业率从9%下降到了7%，赤字率在2007年下降到了史无前例的0.6%。大部分国家成功减税，建立了优厚的社会保障体制，物价稳定，欧元区民众享受到了充分的福利。这样的幸福时光一直持续到2008年，直到2009年10月，希腊政府突然宣布，该年政府财政赤字和公共债务占国内生产总值的比例将分别达到12.7%和11.3%。这两个数字远远超过了欧盟稳定和增长公约规定的3%和60%的上限。
As the father of Euro, do you expect the economic turmoil most recently to your child Euro?
That's what's happened. They didn't realize, and they didn't take into enough account the fact that there's writing on the wall. You build up for a long time, you can build up levels of debt.But after a certain point, you get to a crisis point when you build up too much. It's like water building up in the ceiling. And for a while, you can listen to it pouring in, but eventually the ceiling cracks from the weight of the water. And that's what happened. That's what's happened to all those countries in Southern Europe that was in that position. What the mistake was, of course, you can, part of the reason was the great crisis in 2008, in the European recession.That came about as a result of that, but the big problem was that they should have allowed a left room for in their debt position so they could build up the debt when they needed it.
蒙代尔认为欧债危机并不是欧元区的错，而是欧洲各国过度举债的后果。的确，我们也看到，到2010年，在整个欧元区，绝大部分国家都已经超过了马斯克里赫特峰会规定的财政赤字和公共债务的上限。只有芬兰和卢森堡这两个国家还在遵守这个约定，但是也有评论认为，这些国家过度举债也是不得已而为之，因为根据欧元区的制度设计，各个成员国并没有货币发行权，也不具备独立的货币政策，而是欧洲央行负责整个区域的货币发行和货币政策实施。于是，在风暴来临时，陷入危机的国家无法因地制宜地执行货币政策，更无法通过本币的贬值来缩小债务规模和增加本口出口产品的国际竞争力，只能通过继续举债的办法来渡过难关。这些评论就把质疑的矛头对准了欧元区在设计上的缺陷。
And do you attribute the debt crisis to the deficiency of the Euro system design?
No, because it was a lack of the decision to go forward at the Treaty of Maastricht. There were two wings of this. One was to move forward to European currency. It was believed that would be a catalyst for more political integration. And the desire in the Treaty of Maastricht, and it's written in there, was to move toward a political union in Europe.And what this meant in the fiscal area is that you need to have a fiscal union in Europe. Mm-hmm. Now, when Italy went into the euro area, it already had a debt GDP level of 120%. And Greece had over 100%. Belgium had 130% or more. So these countries had shown in the past, they'd clogged up their future debt availability, so when a big crisis came, like the 2008 crisis, then they didn't have any more room to borrow. And that's the threat of insolvency now.
So if we could be brought back to 10 years earlier, and what will you change to redesign the system?
Well, in the 1990s, I was fully aware of this debt problem and the problem of the deficit, the fact that you had to achieve fiscal discipline. And my plan for the fiscal aspects of it was to impose penalties. You have big fines, you cut off funds that are given, especially to the poor countries, from the European Central Source, cut those funds off if they don't keep their budgets in balance. But politically, the governments decided not to do that.
I remember several years ago there was a debate saying the future of the Eurozone would be a united European Union. And do you think it would be postponed or is on its way of coming?
Well, I think the problem in Europe would have been worse now if there had not been a euro. When this crisis came about in 2008, the whole world went down, and it was started in the United States, and the U.S. was largely, to a large part, to blame for it, and not entirely, but partly. Then this, when Europe was struck with this, they would have been in array. Now, the problems would have been different. It wouldn't have been the kind they have now. The problems then, with their own separate currencies, would have been mass inflation.
欧债危机马上就三年的时间了，经历了多米诺骨牌样的蔓延之后，最近一段时间，欧元区终于传出了一些不那么糟糕的消息。我们不妨来看一下。6月17日，希腊提前举行议会选举，新民主党获胜，暂时避免了希腊退出欧元区的危险。7月21日，欧元区领导人召开紧急峰会，并达成协议。根据这一协议呢，欧元区将与国际货币基金组织和私营部门一起为希腊再提供1090亿欧元的贷款，并将欧洲金融稳定工具的规模从2500亿欧元扩大至4400亿欧元。九月六日，欧洲中央银行货币政策会议宣布将重启购买欧元区成员国的国债计划。那么这些消息呢，令欧洲人稍稍喘了一口气，但是依然有很多不确定的因素，随时会给欧元区带来新的麻烦。不过蒙代尔坚持认为，如果没有欧元区，这些国家现在的情况会更糟。而且已经80高龄的蒙代尔正在推动另一个区域性单一货币的出现，那就是亚元。他被称为欧元之父。
Well, I don't call myself the father. There are other people called it.
面对欧元区的困境，他在想什么？
Fiscal aspects of it was to impose penalties.
他通过货币视角观察中国经济走向。
China will be able to keep its hand in partly in all phases at the same time, all different levels.
欢迎收看中央电视台财经频道特别节目《欧元波动中的蒙代尔》。欢迎回来，继续和蒙代尔来讨论货币问题。蒙代尔一直努力让自己看起来与众不同。在2004年，他又做出了一个出人意料的决定，那就是定居北京。在2005年，蒙代尔获得了北京市的永久居留权，这是北京市引进的第一位诺奖得主。这些年的蒙代尔呢，在北京的潘家园逛旧货市场，吃四川火锅，还练习写毛笔字。当然，他对人民币的兴趣也越来越大。
Well, it'd be because the GDP of China would be larger than Europe in 2030. No doubt, because Europe is probably on the average relative to the world income is rather declining with static or negative population growth. And America is still growing in population, so it's going to grow too, along with its technology and other things that go on. So I think that's 2030. My prediction about that is a no-brainer. It sounds that to me the emphasis over the last several years on making the RMB an international currency is rather immature, because it would be like maybe the U.S. trying to do it in the 19th century. And it's not up to the stage yet. Time will come, but the markets will reflect that when the currency becomes acceptable and people want to hold a lot of it and it becomes available. But right now, China's currency is not convertible. So if you have a currency, a kind of, they call them mousetrap currencies, that you can get into them, but you can't get out of them. Now you'd have to, you could do two things. You could develop First of all, international convertibility, that's what the European countries did in the early post-war period, internationally first, and then after a while, complete convertibility all throughout. I don't know how long it would take before China moves to that. It's not easy.
在人民币升值的问题上，蒙代尔也持有与美国政客们不同的观点。在他看来，中国的货币稳定对于所有的国家来说都是非常重要的。他甚至认为中国货币运行非常良好，没有任何必要对它进行任何的更改。有记者跟他讨论中国应该如何应对来自各方逼迫人民币升值的压力时，蒙代尔用中文给出了九个字，那就是中国应以不变应万变。对于中国经济当前面临的困难，蒙代尔一如既往地表明了他对中国的信心。当然，他观察的角度依然是货币。
Yeah, as we see the sharp decline in the foreign investment, is there any concern for you?
Well, I think China's growth has slowed, definitely, and this is a slow year for China, maybe 7.5% or something, but lower than would have been in the past. I think that it's a good time to, time of transition between the leadership and the government. It's a good time to reevaluate and have forums like this to discuss, is there a need for reevaluation of China's economic policy? What are the directions, new dimensions? China is such a huge economy, population is so large. And so China will be able to keep its hand in partly in all phases at the same time, all different levels.
Do you have any advice for China based on the lessons we learned from Japan and U.S.?
China will have to move up the scale toward more capital-intensive goods in the same way that Japan did in the 1950s and 60s, in the 1970s. And then Japan had to move up the scale as they'll move to the interior, the labor-intensive goods to the interior, the coastal regions, higher, richer coastal regions will move toward the more capital-intensive areas. And so you'll still be able to keep a very substantial amount of exports coming from the underdeveloped regions in China, which are in West China. And West China is one of the prospects where very large growth could come. I think the corporation tax in the United States is very bad. I think it's 35%. It needs to be cut down to 20%. And maybe it will be in the future because the U.S. takes 35% away from a corporation, which diminishes the rate of return available to the private sector. And that's hurting American corporations. One of the reasons it accounts for the decline of the American manufacturing industries here. But I think China needs to worry about this too. There may come time when China needs a supply side revolution.
2003年的春天，在北京被世界卫生组织列为非典疫区的时候，蒙代尔冒着风险将自己的公司从纽约总部迁至北京，以显示对中国的信心。不仅如此呢，蒙代尔早在2001年的上海 APEC 会议以及2009年的诺奖北京论坛上就多次表示，亚洲建立统一货币的经济条件已经具备，并取名叫亚元。
At the very beginning of this century, you raised the concept of the Asian currency.
Well, I talked about an Asian currency even in 2001 at the Hong Kong meeting, and I proposed that as a possibility. But if you had a single currency in Asia, you'd have to have a security area in Asia. That is a war-free zone. You'd have to have treaty alliances that would be correct. What you could have, though, in Asia, in the meantime, you're a long way away from that in Asia, but in the meantime, you could go to a fixed exchange rate zone. Each country keeping their own currency, but keeping to a kind of a fixed exchange rate, and that would be a good idea too, based around. But you'd have to have stability of the dollar and against the euro and against China and against Japan.
就在我们完成了对蒙代尔先生的专访之后，美联储刚刚推出了第三轮量化宽松政策，也就是所谓的 QE3。这轮不是上限的宽松政策呢，在市场上引起了非常强烈的争议。一些新兴经济体就明确表达了反对，他们担心这轮政策唯一的受益者可能只有美国。那么这一次美联储印钞机再次开足马力，将会对中国的经济带来怎样的影响？在今天的节目播出之前呢，我就这个问题再次拨通了蒙代尔先生的电话。 在他看来 ,QE3 对于中国经济来说是一把双刃剑。短期内美元的贬值会使得中国的出口变得更加困难。但是长远来看，若是 QE3 能够使得美国经济好转，将会拉动对中国出口产品的需求。但他呢也再三强调 ,QE3 带来的全球通货膨胀却是无法避免的。今天的节目就是这样，感谢您的收看，欢迎继续关注财经频道的其他节目。我是艾诚，再见。